So for this morning's keynote address, we're honored to have Jerry Gabrielse with us. Jerry is the Board of Trustees Professor in Physics at Northwestern University, where he directs the Center for Fundamental Physics at Low Energy and has done that since its founding in 2018. Jerry attended Trinity Christian College just south of Chicago and graduated from Calvin with a bachelor's degree. He earned his master's and PhD at the University of Chicago and then completed a postdoc with Nobelist Hans Delmecht at Washington University. Prior to last year, he was the George Vasmer Leverett Professor of Physics at Harvard, where he chaired the physics department for many years. He started and continues to lead the low-energy anti-proton and anti-hydrogen team at CERN in Switzerland, and his work has paved the way in incredibly precise measurements of fundamental particles and the study of antimatter. He's testing fundamental laws of physics like CPT invariance that relates charge, parity, and time. As someone who's well outside the world of particle physics, I am just fascinated by the fact that his team at CERN was the first to trap antiprotons and that his Harvard team held single electrons in a trap for months at a time to measure their properties. Single cell experiments no longer seem tiny and technically difficult anymore. Jerry is a member of the National Academy of Science, a fellow of the American Physical Society, and a member of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences. He's won numerous awards from scientific societies, but is most proud of Harvard's Levinson Memorial Teaching Prize for excellence in undergraduate teaching, which I think bodes well for our enjoyment of his lecture this morning. He has served his undergraduate alma maters, Trinity Christian and Calvin College, in many ways, including being a member of the Board of Trustees and the Academic Affairs Committee when I was a faculty member at Trinity. And when I went through my first formal review as a faculty member there, I was warned that the guy with the beard that isn't wearing a suit is really smart, and he's probably going to ask you hard questions. But the other link I had to Jerry was he gave actually a wonderful lecture to celebrate an inauguration of a president at Trinity Christian on celebrating randomness and God's sovereignty, which I thought was such a great topic for a Calvinist college. And so today, Jerry's going to reflect on faith and science with his lecture, God Decides, We Measure. Jerry.
Wasn't sure how that was going to go. Is this live? Yeah. I wasn't sure how this was going to go. Just before I came up here, then Robin reminded me that I had been a board member and had asked her questions, you know, at Trinity College, and I immediately realized that this was the time for revenge, and she could do. But fortunately, she's a good-hearted person and didn't twist the knife quite as deeply as I might have if the roles were reversed. I'm going to give a lecture today, God Decides, We Measure. It's a pleasure to be here. I think this is the first time I've been at Wheaton College, if I remember right. Since many decades ago, I was offered admission, and I came here to look at it. And I didn't end up coming here. But the buildings seem a lot different than what I remember from a lot of years ago. So there's been something going on. This is the first time, well, it's really the first time I've been at an ASA meeting. I don't know what the ASA is about so much as I should, and I apologize for that. I'm a member of the AAAS, okay? But that's not this, okay? I was confused for a while. And the AAAS actually stands for two things. There's the American Association for the Advancement of Science, which is a large society. But if you just add one A and you become a completely different and bigger organization. And the American Academy of the Arts and Sciences also uses AAAS, and this is the AAS. So I'm just getting it all sorted out now. Now, I should say that for many years I subscribed to the ASA newsletter, I guess. I didn't read it very often, but I felt that encouraging Christians to think about science was a good thing. But I checked with my wife, who's here somewhere, and she said, we're no longer getting it. And I think that happened when I went on sabbatical or something, and we kind of lost the subscription. So maybe I have to sign in again. So since I don't really know who you are, let me ask some questions, okay? How many of you are active scientists? Oh, that's really good. Okay, and how many of you are graduate students? A few. How many of you are theologians? Okay, and how many of you are at universities? And how many are at companies? A few. Oh, that's a big mix. Okay, I did peek in at an ASA meeting once when I first went to Harvard, and I just showed up, okay, because there was a speaker I wanted to hear. I don't think I paid the registration fee. So that plus interest I probably owe you, okay. But when I was there, I asked people who they were, and at that time I couldn't find any scientists to speak of, which was, this is a real different thing then. It's really evolved in some way, so that's great. Okay. Now, it's a bit unusual for an active physicist like me to give a lecture like this. I give a lot of lectures, to be sure. My record was 1 year I gave 50 outside lectures besides my Harvard lectures. But essentially, all of these were about physics, okay, at professional conferences, university colloquia, popular science venues, and even high schools. And I like to talk about experiments, and so I'm going to do that today too, okay? How we observe the dance of a single particle that we suspend in essentially empty space, and how our precise measurement of the properties of an elementary particle tests the most precise predictions of the most fundamental mathematical descriptions of physics. How we produce and capture atoms made entirely of antimatter and probe them with lasers. How we use the immense electric field within polar molecules to look for predicted distortions of the electron charge. This is great stuff, and I get a huge kick out of talking about it, even though I'm more than sick of airplanes and hotels. But a lecture on science and faith is quite different, and most active physicists do not give such lectures. I'll use a graph to illustrate what giving lectures on science and faith suggests to most physicists about my scientific career. So here's the progress of a scientific career, okay? It's very straightforward here. There's two axes for those of you who don't plot very much. This is high success, and this is low success, and this is time, okay? And so the first thing you do is you be born. Now, you don't have a lot of control of that, okay? So that point is sort of boring. But then you write your first scientific paper, hopefully not so long after. And then you write more papers, okay? And then you get to be well-known suddenly. You know, you haven't changed any, but the world suddenly starts to say, oh, this person has done some stuff. So then you write your first review paper. Well, that's not about your work, that's about a lot of other people's work, okay? So the slope is changing. And then they make you department chair, okay? And then they give you prizes, because after all, you have to motivate these people who are doing all the grunt work for everybody else. And then they put you in the National Academy, but the last step is to lecture about religion, all right? So, okay, but despite these perils, okay, I am going to try and give a science and faith lecture, but I do so as an active scientist who has faith. Okay, I'm not a scholar of science and religion, and I don't know the literature, so if you ask me literature questions, I won't know about it, okay? But I will reflect on how my faith enables and energizes my science. And here I always start such lectures with a disclaimer. No one should believe or discard what I say about faith and science because I am a wonderful or terrible person. I'm an intense and driven person. I am aware of an impressive list of personality defects, and those around me can likely identify many more. And for scientists, this is not normally a big problem. I willingly listen to scientists who I know to be not such wonderful people, testing their science as I listen by its own merits. So my request is that you similarly test what I say about faith and science. Who knows, what I say may be useful or even right, despite the fact that it comes from someone who has my list of defects. Science. When folks, especially some Christians, say science says, I sometimes do not recognize what they mean by science. If we are going to reflect on science and faith, we have to at least agree on what science is, for the purposes of my comments anyway. If I were a historian, I would be tempted to give a careful history of how our idea of science and doing science have developed over the centuries. If I were a philosopher, I might try to make a careful, abstract definition of science and its limits. Physicists like me, however, don't have enough available brain cells to deal with such complexity. Believe it or not, one project that my students and I spent many years on is the study of a single, isolated electron. Instead of a general definition of science, I will thus tell you about the common sense game that we play, that we call science, and that we play to learn about a simple electron. I will then attach some labels to elements of this game and call it science, or at least one example of doing some science. The electron particle is very common, as you all know. All the matter we see in our universe is made out of lightweight electrons, along with protons and neutrons that are about 2,000 times heavier. Who would have thought that with only three different kinds of particles, one could make all the diversity we see in the universe? Donald Trump and I are made out of the same three particles. Who could imagine? Okay. There are a lot of electrons in the universe. In my body, there are nearly 10 to the 29th power. This is an incredibly large number, so large that I don't even know how to make it seem real. If I lined up all of my electrons, spaced 1 inch apart, the line of electrons would go around the Earth's equator more than 10 to the 19th times. I don't know how to make 10 to the 19th seem palatable. These numbers themselves are just way too large for us to imagine in our imaginations, where we are based on common experience. The electron itself is amazing. It's so small that the most precise way to measure its size, to see if it's made of some hard bits inside, is to shoot other particles as fast as possible into the electron. This is a limited way to do science, of course, crashing things together. It wouldn't be a great method for determining the anatomy of chickens, for example. Okay, but it does work for particles. Okay, and if there are hard bits inside of the electron, some of the fast-moving particles would bounce back, and this doesn't happen. In fact, physicists have detected essentially no size at all for the electron. Imagine that, a real platonic point particle. I mean, we experimenters know that's not possible, okay, intuitively, but there it is. From what we can tell, this particle that fills our body and the universe, whose orbit size in atoms gives size to our body, this amazing electron may itself have no size at all. However, this particle with no size has mass and charge. I find it counterintuitive to fit mass and charge into no size. Okay? When many of us were children, we played with tops. A spinning top would not fall over when it was spinning. The amazing electron acts as if it is spinning in this way, even though there is nothing rotating as far as we can tell. In addition to charge and mass, the electron with no size that has spun without rotating, this electron also acts like a magnet. Some of my graduate students and I spent more than 20 years measuring the size of this magnet. Why? Well, for many decades, physicists have been developing an intricate mathematical description of elementary particles like the electron, and this description we unimaginatively call the standard model. Okay, in this serious but fun game we call science, the goal is to make a description, a mathematical description, that we can compare to the properties of particles that, so that we can compare the prediction and the measurement. After scores of person years of concentrated effort and many years of supercomputer time, the standard model predicted the size of the magnet in the no-size electron. In some units that I do not have time to discuss, the size of the electron magnetic moment is, it's given in this top line. That's lots of digits, okay? There's almost 13 significant digits there, okay? This is an incredible precision, okay? Parts in 10 to the 13. It is the most precise prediction of the standard model of particle physics. It's the most precise prediction of the property of an elementary particle. And it, in fact, I think it's the most precise numerical prediction ever made. But is this prediction right? My students and I decided to test this prediction. If we measured a magnet size that differed from the prediction, then we would prove the mathematical description was wrong, or at least had some things that had to be fixed. We could never prove the theoretical mathematical description to be right, of course. Even if we measured the magnet size that was predicted, we could not prove that some other property of the mathematical description would not be inconsistent with a later measurement that came in from a different angle. Or we could not prove that in time the moment would not change. We did not know what we would find, but we were prepared to look. Here's my title, God Decides, We Measure. A new version of this apparatus is now at Northwestern University. We think we can make a 10 times more precise measurement. Okay, in this apparatus, we suspend a single electron all by itself, and we keep it isolated, as mentioned in the introduction, for many months at a time. And we lower the temperature of its environment to just a tenth of a degree above absolute zero, the temperature where all motion ceases. And we actually probe the quantum structure of the homemade atom that we thereby make in the lab. Our electrical signals make the electron dance a quantum dance between the lowest quantum states of its motion. As a Calvinist, I love the fact that reality is random at its core, because it helps my fellow Calvinists that I grew up with be a little less deterministic, at least if they think about it, okay? Because the dance took place in the incredibly strong magnetic field from a superconducting magnet, the dance tells us the size of the electron's magnet. We were able to measure the size even more precisely than it was predicted, to an unusually high precision of 3 parts in 10 to the 13. Since some of you are dying to know the size of the electron's magnet, here it is in Bohr magnetons, okay? It's this number here, okay? Now, it's interesting that until very recently, this past year, the measurements essentially agreed within an error bar. Now we get this interesting development that the new measurement that enabled the prediction to be made more accurately means that there's a slight disagreement. That's how science works. You look, you probe, and just when you think you understand something, there's a new layer of the onion, and there's something else that you haven't understood before, and you get to look there. Okay. Now, last September, another electron measurement we did was reported in Nature. In response to predictions that the charge of the electron should be slightly squished. Remember, the charge is inside of an electron with no size, and the charge is squished. It has an electric dipole moment. Weird everywhere. okay? And despite the lack of any size, two colleagues and I, with our students, measured the roundness of the electron. And at a precision 144 times better than had ever been done before, we found that the electron was still round, despite predictions of some theories that it should be squished. So that mystery continues. Sometimes the predictions of our descriptions are right. Sometimes the predictions are wrong. God decides, we measure. What do these examples illustrate about science? Science is a game with rules that the scientists agree upon. We make a description of some part of reality we think we understand. We make new predictions based on this description, then we measure to see if the prediction is right or wrong. We never completely prove the description is right, but if we fail to measure results that disagree, then as a community, we slowly reach a consensus that our description may be right. The sociology of adapting a new description or paradigm is very interesting. I will not discuss this except to say almost always some scientists are dissenters who attempt alternative descriptions. That's part of being a science. You need some crackpots on the fringe who are always making sure that we in the center do the job right. Even if 98% of climate scientists agree that the Earth is warming and that greenhouse gases from human activities are contributing, there will always be 2% being quoted as they explore other explanations. The numbers are, I just made them up. Okay. Faith. God decides we measure is actually a faith statement. You may know the Bible's definition of faith in Hebrews 11. Faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. The God of the Bible is not mentioned in this definition because it is possible to have faith that is not in God. Faith to me describes the assumptions that we all must make without proof. I have faith in the God described in the Bible. I have confidence in this God from whom I derive hope and meaning, even if I do not see him. Many of my students and colleagues have faith that is not in God, but is instead faith in nature or humanity or in themselves. Without proof, they assume that serving these alternatives to God give meaning and hope to their life and their science. This seems to me to be a crucial point that we Christians should stress as we give account of the hope that is in us. Everyone has faith, be we Christian or non-Christian. A lost element of Christian apologetics is in making sure that the universality of faith is recognized and identifying the God substitutes that are common. The key difference, then, between Christian and non-Christian is not that one has faith and one does not, as is often said. Both have faith, either in God or some substitute. What is different is in who or what one places one's faith. God. Now it is time to describe the God in whom I place my faith. Referring to God is more than a little frightening to me. Why? A God worth having, certainly the God I read of in the Bible, a God capable of being responsible for the remarkably intricate and diverse universe that we study, such a God must be much greater, more complicated, and more powerful than we can ever imagine or even hope to experience or describe in the limited language of human experience. Even for people who do not believe in God, if they suspend their belief and imagine with me, a God who is intelligent and powerful beyond human comprehension, the master of the universe, listening to and evaluate what I publicly claim this morning to know about God, this thought is embarrassing, even scary. I imagine that this God has long since grown tired, perhaps even a bit numb, of overtly religious types who write books, pound pulpits, or expound to teleprompters, authoritatively pretending to capture the essence of God by enumerating human-like characteristics they think they recognize. I further imagine that this God is just as tired and numb from folks who claim to speak with scientific authority about their own God delusion, a gutted version of God so limited that they think it could be disproved with probability arguments. For preachers and theologians to make such mistakes, to be so arrogantly certain, is one thing. Scientists, especially physicists, should know better. After being awed by the unbelievable vastness and always surprising intricacy of the physical world, we physicists should be more humble and respectful of the limitations of our scientific craft and knowledge, whether our religious assumptions are those of a Christian or an atheist. I am not very inventive in my view of God. My God is the God of Job, the epic tale of suffering and triumph that is part of the Bible. I highly recommend this tale to you religious types. I claim that the story is more about God and less about heroic Job than is commonly supposed. I also recommend this epic to you scientific types. You will not find more appreciation anywhere of the wonderful way that our universe is put together. Time being short, I will simply quote some examples of the statements from the book of Job attributed to God. Job, in his pain, expresses some doubts about God's justice. This provokes a strong response from the Master of heaven and earth. The fierce response shows how proud and involved God is with his universe, his earth, his creatures, and his antimatter. Out of a storm, God thunders, "Where were you when I laid the earth's foundation? Tell me if you understand. Who marked off its dimensions? Surely you know. Who stretched out a measuring line across it? On what were its footings set? Or who laid its cornerstones while the morning stars sang together and all the angels shouted for joy? Who shut up the sea behind the doors when it burst forth from the womb? When I made the clouds its garment and wrapped it in thick darkness, when I fixed limits for it and set its doors and bars in place, when I said, 'This far you may come and no farther. Here is where your proud waves halt.' Can you raise your voice to the clouds and cover yourself with a flood of water? Do you send the lightning bolts on their way? Do they report to you?" Page after page of passionate prose pours from the proud maker of heaven and earth, leaving no doubt of God's fierce pride in a creation that clearly gets his close attention. Job gets the message. One does not doubt or question the master of the universe. Humbled, he offers God his apology and his repentant silence. Faced daily by a wonderful reality filled with these layers within layers of unbelievably intricate structure, I find it easy to ghostwrite extra verses for God's use when he must next confront my doubt. "Where were you when I crafted the antiprotons you play with, when I bound the quarks within and ordered them never to venture out alone? Before the Big Bang, who presided? Who seeded the explosion that defies the imagination? And who steered the world friendly to life from this unlikely beginning?" The great master of the universe still has innumerable reasons to be proud of the intricacy of the universe, much, even most of which, we really do not understand. If the epic tale of Job were to be written today, many of the words and images would be different, to be sure, but I think the point would be exactly the same. The Bible. My basic understanding about God clearly does not come from my science. I know of no description of God that I can make which leads to predictions that my students and I can test with repeated and verifiable measurements and with the methods of science. My science thus does not enable me to make scientific statements about God. Based upon the science game that I play, as a scientist, I cannot even say that God exists. As a scientist, I also cannot conclude based on my science that God does not exist. I learn about God from the Bible. I find John Calvin's analogy to be very useful. The Bible, he says, is the eyeglasses that God provides to us to make it possible to see that God is behind the science. Through these Bible glasses, these corrective lenses, I came to appreciate the wonderful God who breathes and holds together all of this universe, science, the incredibly difficult, clever, twisted, and powerful master of the universe. I take the Bible to be literally true. Any part of the Bible that intends to be history, I try hard to read as history. Any part that intends to be hymns of worship, I try hard to read as hymns of worship. Any part that intends to be poetry, I know is really important, and I try to read it as poetry as best I can. Any part that intends to convey meaning and purpose, I try to read as such. To add to my view of God, a view I find gives meaning to my science and empowers my science, I quote two other parts of the Bible. First, when Moses asked God what name he should use to describe God, the answer he got was very unusual, even arrogant. God said his name was, I am who I am. God did not say he was the greatest ruler or pharaoh of all time, or the most powerful. In the descriptive name he chose, there was no extrapolation or exaggeration of human characteristics attempted or alluded to in any way. He was different. He was God. He was the master of the universe. The language of human experience was incapable of a good description. God was who he was, a God worth having, a God so much beyond human description that he would not be represented as a superhuman. The second Bible quotation that reveals a view of God that gives context and meaning to my science is from the first chapter of the Bible. I will paraphrase it, but we'll read it for the purpose that this meaning story was intended, in my view, to demonstrate who was in control and what he was trying to accomplish. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. From a dark and formless mass, God made light. He separated the sky, land, and water. He filled the sea with fish, put animals and people in it. He looked over all he had made, and he said, "That's good." The sky was good, the land was good, the water was good, the plants were good, the sun, moon, and stars were good, the fish were good, the animals and people were good. God was clearly proud as he looked over his creation and pronounced it all very good. For some years, and alas it continues, some Christians, particularly in the U.S., have quarreled about how God created the world and universe. Did God use 6 days or was it longer? How did he manage to have lights and plants growing on earth before he made the sun? It is amazing how certain some can be about the amazing past, about things that happened long ago and in our absence. And I think the quarrelers miss the whole point of the creation story. The point of the creation story given to the people of Israel in the language or their predecessors in the language they had and could understand, the point is that God breathed the whole creation. God made his creation for his own enjoyment. Everything that came into being did so because he wished it. Everything that remains does so because he wishes it. This notion that God breathes the universe leads to the metaphor that I find so useful. Okay, I visualize God as holding the world, the universe actually, in God's hands. Except for these hands faithfully, actively, and continuously holding the universe together, it would simply come apart and cease to be. The presence of evil, an interesting topic, makes it difficult for us to see God's beautiful creation. It has become harder for us to see that it is God's hands that are faithfully holding our reality together. We really need the biblical glasses to do so. Whether we are Christians or not, however, we all perceive some of the ways that God holds things. One way that God holds things together we call gravity. Atoms, rocks, planets, and stars all attract each other. God's gravity makes the sun attract the earth, so the earth orbits the sun. We are grateful because we always stay approximately the same distance from our source of heat and light. We never need freeze and never need fry. God's gravity also attracts us to the earth. With every step, I return to earth, and I am grateful. How different life would be if I feared that any step would launch me into orbit, outside the atmosphere that I need to breathe, survive, and thrive. Some of the ways that God holds our reality together, the ways that God holds most tightly, we call laws. Newton's law and Coulomb's law are familiar to every physics student. God's gravity, as I mentioned, we typically call the law of gravity. And whether I am Christian or not doesn't change the result. All are pulled to earth by God's gravity, whether or not we recognize God is behind the phenomenon. I doubt that we could sustain life on earth if God did not hold physical reality so tightly. Long ago, I wondered if Christians should do physics differently from others. Over my years in physics, however, I have found that my non-Christian friends and I generally have no trouble agreeing upon the methods and outcomes of good physics. I now understand this to be because God holds the physical reality described by physics so tightly in his hands, so faithfully, that none of us are able to mess it up much, however wacky and mistaken is our view of the world. I am glad for this state of affairs. It seems to me that similar agreement between Christians and non-Christians is not always so easy for other parts of reality that God holds less tightly. Four implications of this view. The view of a God-breathed, God-sustained universe is exhilarating, energizing, and enabling for me as a scientist. It is the view of God, the great I am, that I learn when I view his universe through the God glasses he kindly provided. This view of God-breathed, God-sustained universe has many implications, of which, as I said, I will mention four. First, it provides an answer to the question, why do we do science? It is simple. We do science, even pure science, with no evident or sought-after applications to make God happy. It's no coincidence that doing science makes some of us happy and satisfied as well. This is what some of us were intended to do. The whole culture reaps the rewards of even pure science, as we invent transistors, lasers, medical imaging devices, and these revolutionize our capabilities. My work, for example, led to a patent now expired for an improved magnetic resonance imaging device. I never thought of that. I was trying to solve the problem I had that the magnetic field was varying in my lab at Harvard. Job's God clearly takes great pride in his masterpiece, a universe of unbelievable intricacy and scale, and I think he gets a great kick out of watching as we unravel the intricate ways that he crafted things. The flip side is he is sometimes amused and we get stumped for a while. I imagine him chuckling as my students and I, while thinking that our experiments have finally made it possible to understand completely the quantum mechanics of our electron system, blunder upon yet another clever twist built into reality. God decides, God is delighted when we measure. Second implication. A second implication of a God-breathed, God-sustained universe is that the master of the universe could make the earth and universe by whatever process he jolly well pleased, in whatever time period he jolly well chose. For reasons I do not completely understand, this is much more obvious to Christians outside the U.S. than to Christians in the U.S., he could have formed the universe in a very short Big Bang, followed by 15 years. We go out and look, and if that's what we find, so be it. He could have sustained the evolution of life forms. We go out and look, and if that's what we find, so be it. God decides, we measure. This is our place in the universe. Third implication, I call the no fear principle. This is really important for students, I think, who are trying to be Christian and doing science. A third implication of a God-breathed, God-sustained universe is the no-fear principle. Christians doing science have every right to expect that their science will not produce results that contradict their faith. The God who produced the universe for his pleasure also provided the Bible glasses that allow us to discern this God. There can't be a contradiction. Now, having said that, there are many things that I do not yet understand about my science. There are many things that I do not understand about my Christianity. There are many things that I do not understand about the way that my science and my Christianity fit together. For example, I do not understand how God could become human and live on earth. I do not understand and even find it somewhat distasteful that Jesus would need to die so that I can live forever. But when in physics I do not understand something, this does not generally tempt me to abandon the framework and methodology of physics. Instead, I look on the unknown as a challenge and direct my physics efforts to maximize the likelihood that one day I will understand. I take the same approach to these matters. Someday, I hope to understand. In fact, one new component of my notion of heaven, the new heavens, and the new earth that the Bible speaks about is a renewed place where we can much more readily obtain answers to these questions. I imagine the new earth to be a place where we can pursue science with more clarity of purpose and without the distractions we now suffer. There will be no grant proposals to write in heaven. But the point here is God decides, we measure without fear. A fourth implication of a God-breathed, God-sustained universe is that there is no contradiction between doing science and praying. I hope that you will indulge me if I conclude by illustrating this implication with a personal story, which has a happy ending and no exploitation of difficult circumstances is intended. Many, many years ago, my teenage son was told that he had no more than a 5% chance to survive his cancer. Cancer that CT and bone scans showed had spread through his body. And I reacted as any of you would, as any scientist parent would, seeking second and third opinions about the diagnosis, about treatment plans, and grilling the medical doctors as only a scientist could. They had extra people on staff when I came to the hospital. As some of you know firsthand, it is really hard to watch one you love undergo rather barbaric therapies like chemotherapy and radiation treatment, still the best medical options in too many cancer cases. I am delighted to report that my son did survive and that he is still free of cancer, married, has grandchildren that give me trouble, okay, and he's now the curriculum director for science in a major school system. I am very grateful to his doctors, and I am very grateful to God. Now, why tell this story here? The reason is that in parallel with my relentless insistence upon the best medical solution, I repeatedly asked of God that my son would be cured and that all the cancer cells would die, that the chemo and radiation damage to his body would be minimized. I relied upon a deep and long-held faith in God, who was not only the master of the universe, but who remarkably was willing to listen to me. I see no contradiction or inconsistency in dealing with all this awful situation as a person of science and as a person of faith. A God worth having, it still seems to me, must be so unimaginably more clever and more powerful than we limited humans could ever comprehend, that I could seek his help even if my science did not comprehend how he might provide it. My title, God Decides, We Measure, is intended to stress the importance of knowing our humble place in God's vast universe. Knowing our place is critical as we do science on our tiny planet. It is also important as we care for our planet, using and knowing what our science reveals. God's spaceship Earth has been placed in our care. Job's God is intensely proud of this planet and intensely interested and watching closely. Earth is not our planet to exploit for our short-term profit. Of course, we should not pollute its environment. Of course, we should not let human activity increase its greenhouse gas blanket, melt its glaciers, increase its sea level, and flood its impoverished peoples, etc. Of course, we should not be propping up the most willfully, scientifically ignorant, and self-worshipping leadership our country has ever seen. We should not be cheering for the repeal of all laws and regulations that will preserve Earth for our children. Wind turbines do not cause cancer, okay? Repeated falsehoods do not become true. Truth is absolutely required for good science, for good government, and for pleasing our God. We Christians need to prophesy to our fellow travelers and to our culture, perhaps inspired by the Old Testament prophets who delivered God's word about how we should treat widows, orphans, and the poor. We do not someday wish to hear, "Where were you when I was hungry and thirsty? Where were you when I sought asylum? Where were you when my glaciers were melted, when poor populations were being flooded?" In conclusion, I believe in a God who is beyond the reach of science. I believe in a God who is delighted when we scientists finally unravel another layer of our unbelievably intricate and wonderful reality. God decides, we measure. God is as important a part of my view of reality as is the physics that I love. I find that Christianity offers the most simple and most economical and most compelling explanation of reality as I encounter it. Christian faith enables and energizes my science. I have tried as honestly as I can to expose my starting points, my religious roots to you. If you disagree, and I'm sure many of you will, I hope that this lecture will at least prompt you to examine your own starting points, the set of basic assumptions or metaphor which you believe without proof and which you use to ascribe meaning to your lives in science and outside.
Thanks, Jerry. We have some time for questions, and I'd ask that you come and use one of the two microphones up front if you have them. Okay, I'm going to start then with the thing that blew my mind the most. Can you explain, without using really, really hard math, how you can have no size and a shape?
No.
Okay. The whole thing about an electron having a dipole moment kind of was like runner-up on that.
You know, explain is this funny concept, right? What does explain mean? Explain means that you take something that puzzles some of us, and you try and answer the puzzlement, okay, by using something simpler upon which we all agree.
Yes.
Right now, I think we have to make our peace with the fact that Earth at its root, that physical reality at its root is random. Okay, it has point particles in it, okay? These point particles behave differently than all the balls we've ever thrown in our lives, okay? And I don't know of any primitive thing upon which we can all agree to give an explanation for that other than to say, God made it that way.
I can live with that.
I'm afraid I'm feeling rather sorry for your poor electron.
So you're feeling sorry for my electron? Oh.
Yeah, what did you do that to it for? No, what I really want to know is how did you do it? What can you explain in some reasonably short period of time how you bottle an electron?
You're in good company. I.I. Rabi, a famous Nobel-winning physicist, he came to the university by my lab when this was done. And in the keynotes to the conference, his one comment was he felt great sympathy for the poor electron that had been isolated here for 10 months. So I ran out and I got the only signature I've ever gotten. I typed that up and I ran to him and said, "Could you sign this statement?" So that's the one autograph I've ever collected in my life. How do we do it? It's pretty easy. Electrons are negatively charged, right? You certainly know from high school chemistry that negative charges don't like other negative charges, okay? So above and below, we put some other negative charges, okay? So if the electron wants to go this way or go this way, it says, whoops, I don't like those electrons, and I'm going to stay in the middle. Now, it can go out to the side. So what we do is we put a magnet so that its field, you know, the direction the compass would point, is vertical. And one piece of physics that you may or may not know, so I'll teach you in case you don't, is that if you have a magnetic field and you have a charge, it goes in a circle. So the charge goes in a circle this way, and it's kept from going out either end by the negative charges, and we love it, okay? So it's not an isolation relationship. We're coddling that electron. That's the way to think of it.
Thank you very much for your talk. I'm a physicist myself, and so this is great to hear from you about all these aspects, and a Calvinist as well. So I appreciate your remark about the fact that randomness is at the root of reality. Mm-hmm. But yet you said that in physics, one of the things that lets non-Christian friends and yourself have things in common is because God holds the reality together so tightly that we can't mess it up. But then you said other disciplines may have more problem with this because God holds them less tightly. What did you mean by that, and can you explain a bit from your perspective how other disciplines have more of trouble with that than physicists do?
Well, probably I'm not the authority who should speak to that, at least not pretend that I have authority. But for example, one thing, if you're in an English department, okay, well, let me say this. One thing about physics is we have a doctrine of right and wrong, okay? And that's because God holds things so tightly that I can actually say, your measurement was wrong, okay? Or you can get tenure by proving that one of my measurements was wrong, right? We have a doctrine of right and wrong. That's why I think there are sometimes more Christians in physics departments than there are in divinity schools, okay? In the humanities, you don't have a doctrine of right and wrong these days that's so pronounced, okay? You don't say that novel is wrong, for example, okay? Or, you know, it's more loosey-goosey viewed from the eyes of a physicist, okay? Now, I say that, you know, God is giving us more freedom to write our novels, okay? He gives us more freedom of how we organize our families, okay? He gives us more freedom about a lot of different concepts than he does in physical reality. If anybody doubts that gravity is a law of physics, you just go to the nearest third-story window and you step out and you persuade yourself that, in fact, gravity applies to you too. It's universal. Okay, you don't have that in all of the other disciplines. Okay, and so that's all I meant. Now, I haven't really, like I say, I'm not a scholar of these things, so these are just throwaway comments, and you can throw that away if it's not useful, but that's just my impression as I look at it.
Okay, let's take one from the other side here.
Hi, I'm an ecologist, and we like charismatic things. I was just wondering, did your pet electron, did you give it a name?
No, I was a postdoc who had been told at the University of Washington that I had no hope of ever becoming a faculty member there, okay? So I thought my career was over. So one of the things I thought I was gonna do is once we kept it for a year, okay, then we would have a birthday party for it and probably name it at that time. And I was gonna call Newsweek magazine, which was then a print publication in the New York Times and so on. Then I got a phone call from one of my colleagues whose name I won't mention, and he said, Jerry, you're going to be really upset, but we just lost the electron, I think. And we spent 2 days looking for that silly electron, even though it only took 10 minutes. Okay, but what had happened is there was a frequency synthesizer, which is a device that makes a radio signal, and it had lots of knobs because it had incredible precision in setting the frequency, you know, setting the station. And someone had clicked it one click the wrong way, okay, and instead of cooling the particle to the center, it gradually heated it out, okay? So I recovered, and I'm not scarred by that so much yet. My recovery's not complete, but that was when we were going to name it. So no, we didn't name it, so okay. Yeah.
Let's do one more on each side.
Thank you for your talk. As I was listening and you were talking about the different types of faiths that people, regardless of their religious background, have, in terms of how you brought your own views of the study of theology into how you understand physics, how do you think we can bring better philosophical understanding into the field for people who aren't of faith to encourage a more disciplined way that we can put our discoveries within context?
Mm-hmm. I really don't know. One thing I've done in my new center at Northwestern is I've obtained funds to have a visitor to think about possibly these sorts of issues, someone who's not from physics, but that's a little token thing. I really think we need some very professional philosophers and theologians who really take seriously this possibility that everybody has faith, and we have to identify then for others who don't like that language. The language is even objectionable, you know? When you say faith, to scientific colleagues, for example, what they think is some cultic activity that you're dancing on one foot and waving your umbrella and stuff like this, and so we don't even have the language that allows us to talk about religious assumptions that are very good. I don't know how to make that happen. If I knew how, I would make it happen. But I think when someone writes a book, I think the greatest service that Christians can do if they disagree is point out what the faith assumptions were in that book. And I think that's the way we can have a pluralistic society that has different faith commitments. Because if you write a book, and then I'm a critic, and so I write a thing that says, this is the faith assumptions I think I've identified, you can then read that and see if you can live with those faith assumptions. That's one thing. The other thing I can do is take those faith assumptions, and I can say, what other implications are there of those, and see if you can live with those, and vice versa, and you can do it for me. And I think that's the way, in my idealized world, people from different faith points of view would interact. Now, having said that, I don't know of a large movement to make that happen. I lay it out as a challenge to people who are young enough to think that that might be true, or might be possible, and we'll see what happens.
Mm-hmm. Great. Last question here.
A short question. You're talking about measurement, and isn't it more likely that the electron does have a size, but it's just too small for us to measure?
Well, more likely. I mean, we could bet on that because that's something that we have no way to answer. I don't know what the answer is to that. My credentials as far as figuring out how the universe should be made are not so good. If I were the creator of the universe, people would certainly be made out of metal, okay? Because the soft, squishy stuff clearly isn't durable enough to be workable, okay? So I don't know how to answer that question. All I can say is, as of now, we have detected no size. We may detect size, when we can probe deeper, and that would be very interesting, and that would be great, but at least as of now, we haven't detected any size, okay?
Thank you, Jerry. All right, it's time for lunch, and we'll reconvene after that. Metal people. Deb Mercer.